What's going on, guys? And happy daylight savings time. If you guys don't know, the clock shifted forward an hour yesterday. And I swear to God, if it wasn't for all this smart technology, I wouldn't even have a damn clue that we shifted our clocks forward an hour. But this is episode 4.10. And in this episode, I get to talk to Adela Garcia, who is the main person behind the Adela Garcia Classic that's happening in Bastrop, Texas from June 7th through June 9th. This is an NPC show, and on June 9th specifically, it is going to be a natural show. If you guys don't know, the NPC is taking a new approach and diving a little bit more into the natural bodybuilding realm. And this is one of about 10 shows that they're adding on to create a natural show series. For me, who is all about promoting natural bodybuilding and raising awareness for the sport, I definitely wanted to get someone's take that's in the process of what they're exactly doing with that line, what their thought process is behind. And I got to be honest with you, everybody that I've talked to so far about the NPC taking on it is honestly a really positive approach. There seems to be a lot of rift in the natural bodybuilding communities about the NPC now trying to take their stake in the natural bodybuilding world. But the reality is, if there weren't so many federations, if there weren't so many people trying to play politics as well as make it about their brand instead of the sport, there wouldn't have been enough room for the NPC to even take a step into this business. But because there has been so much rift, so much confusion, so much alphabets when it comes to all these different federations, that's why the NPC saw an opportunity to take this. And honestly, I'm excited to see where it goes. And with this as well, I also didn't realize that Adela Garcia is an 8-time Fitness Olympia champion and a 5-time Arnold champion. So it was also fun to dive into her experience as an Olympian, an Olympia champion, and just to get her take on how bodybuilding has evolved from when she started until now. Oh, and the last but not least, in the natural bodybuilding world, you pretty much, if you win an amateur show, you pretty much have your pro card and you could go to any other pro show and then compete. The pro card status and being able to compete on a national stage and then at the Olympia is a completely different process. And as you will be able to tell in this episode, I was utterly confused on how that is. So excuse me on all the different hiccups I had on there. I just think it's hilarious that I just kept on saying, oh, is it this? It's that? No, it's not that. Like, all right, well, I clearly am kind of confused on that. But for everybody else, hope you guys really enjoy this episode. I hope you guys got out of this what I gained out of this, which is a lot of perspective and a lot of optimism for how NPC is going to approach the natural realm. And for that also, guys, you can go follow her at NPC Adela Garcia Classic. And then hope you guys just enjoy this episode. Until next time, deuce.
Hello, Americans. It is with the utmost pride and sincerity that I present this recording as a living testament and recollection of history in the making during our generation.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho, H to the O-V. I used to move snowflakes by the O-Z. I guess even back then you can call me CEO or the R-O-C.
Thing that, I don't know, on your mind fitness-wise?
No, well, I do want to talk a lot about the natural show because I feel like there's a lot of misunderstanding going on. People don't understand that the NPC, natural shows have been going on for a long time. We just mm-hmm. don't have shows in Texas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, back in, I think it was in 2020, I wanted to have another show. So I asked if I can have another show. So now having a show is not something that they're going to give you. Like, okay, not like you can go and buy it at a grocery store. So I asked, and then they said, you know, there is room for natural shows if anybody wants to do it. So, you know, you guys can do it. So I said, well, I want a natural show. And Then it passed a few years because there's so many shows in Texas. They didn't want to continue to put more and more shows. So then they decided to let me have a show. So I was super excited. So I'm going to have it in conjunction with my show this year. But okay. I'm going to see how it goes. And then next year, I wanted to do it in a separate date. So, but there is a lot of natural shows in the NPC. So I just didn't understand why people were kind of wondering why the NPC trying to venture into it, because the NPC has been having natural shows for a long time. It's just, it's up to the promoters. So it's a business and it comes down to money. Of course, with the natural show, it's like you got to spend more money because there's a drug testing involved. So what I'm doing is I was very, very careful about not having charging the athletes to pay for their drug testing. So we are not going to charge the athletes. That's going to be included in their entry fee. Because a lot of people, I know a lot of people go with a polygraph. I don't like polygraph. We're going to go urinalysis. So yeah, we're just going to go urinalysis.
I don't like polygraph either. No, thank God you said that. I don't like it at all either. All right. So for me, right. On the real quick, before we get into that, like I remember my last OCB show, they do a polygraph and they asked me a couple of questions and apparently I failed the first time. Now I know I'm a natural athlete. I don't do anything and it's not like I demonize it. It's just not my preference. Right. And I'm definitely not the kind of person that's gonna enhance myself and then do a natural show. I think that's the most pathetic thing you can do. Exactly. And so when he, you know, first of all, he's just all like, well, hey, we kind of got to redo this test, you know, answer these couple of questions, redo it. And then, all right, I do it. And then in the second time I passed, but I can only imagine where if someone is using and then they know how to control their heart rate or how to answer the questions in a manner where they're not lying, that they can kind of get past it. And it made me kind of question the overall process of getting a poly because, well, if they told me I failed at first and then they did a couple of things to make sure that I passed, then how legitimate is that poly? Right. So,
yeah, plus the polygraph testing, it takes a long time. Like when I started researching, trying to find a person to do the polygraph, because I thought that that's the only way that we were able to do it. But then I didn't read the whole message about promoters can pick from polygraph and urinalysis. I didn't read the whole thing. So I said, oh, I can pick up between either or. I can do both if I want to. So I spoke with my husband, and my husband is like, I don't like polygraph testing. I just feel like people can just fake it. And plus a good polygraph takes more than 20 minutes. Like I researched different places where I was looking for some labs, and some of the labs said, if you are looking for a 15-minute polygraph, this is not the right place. You need to go someplace else, because for a good polygraph, it takes between 1 to 3 hours, I believe. So we don't, you know, we wanted to test the top two. We're going to do your analysis, and that's how we're going to do it for all the athletes. I want to give them a great experience. You know, this is not about competing with anybody else. This is about just recognizing that there's natural athletes can compete in the NPC. I mean, we have different categories. We have true novice, we have novice. And I want to make it that athletes don't feel like, oh, this is just, it's all about the drug testing. It's going to be about, you know, there's people, they just wanted to compete and they want to have a stage. And they don't want to compete against athletes that have been competing for a long time. So this is just for new athletes, anybody that wants to step on stage and have a great time. And if they like it, that's how I started in the sport. I started because I wanted to get in a bikini and I wanted to get on stage. And then all of a sudden I fell in love with the sport. I loved it. And, you know, when you do something that you do it from the heart, it takes you different places. Whether you start making money or not, I wasn't I was not expecting that much, you know, and never expected right. like I was going to win the Olympia or nothing like that. I just went in like, oh, I love this sport. I like it. I like being able to get in shape and know how to control my body. That's the only thing that I have control over it. I know that if I gain 20 pounds, I can lose it. I know how to control that. So those are the, you know, that's what make me fall in love with this sport. And then once I retire, you know, I promoting is another thing, just giving back to the sport, not just giving back by, you know, going to a show, giving back to the sport by having a stage for other athletes in order for them to qualify to the national and also qualify. You know, now I have pro fitness in my, at my show. That's the division that I competed for over 20 years.
Yeah.
So
real quick, it's interesting because I reached out to you because I did want to talk about your show, but then I started obviously researching the person behind the show and I didn't realize, holy crap, you have a lot of accolades in bodybuilding. I didn't realize you're Miss Fitness Olympia eight times.
Five-time
Arnold
Classic.
Yes. Wow. Why don't they talk about you in the same regard as like Jay Cutler or Ronnie? Because I know those guys have Olympias out there resume, but you have eight of them. What? That's bizarre.
We have Lee Haney, Linda Mary, Ronnie Coleman. We're in the eight club of eight the times. Eight, you know, it's eight. Yeah.
Wow. It's like the
legends. Yeah, never in my life I ever thought about that. It's just the first when I won the Arnold. It was like, wow, this is incredible. You know, you get that feeling once you win. That was the biggest show. So in 2004, that was my first win to the Arnold, and then I won the Olympia that year. And then 2005, I lost. And then 2006, I came back, won it. 2007, 2008, injured my knee, ACL repair, and then came back in 2009. So 2013, and then retired. So yeah, it's women, you know, the sport. It's always bodybuilding. We have a lot of women's competing, but it's always going to be a men's sport. And it's always like things have changed, but it's always the men's are always making more money. But I mean, I never care about it. Like it just, even if it was no money, for me, it was like, I wanted a stage. I would love to compete. I have nothing to do with the money. I mean, that was something that added up because once you get to that level of, that was what I was doing for, you know, that was my job. So I got sponsored. So that made it a little bit easier because competing for fitness is hard. Oh, you know, you got to practice. We used to have four rounds. So one round was a 45-second. When I started competing in 1995, that's a long time ago. I lived in Puerto Rico, and I remember I worked at a base, and I remember seeing this flyer. And I just looked at this and I said, I'm going to do that. I'm going to compete in that show. And it was like fitness and bodybuilding. That was the only two divisions that they have in the NPC. So I flew from Puerto Rico to North Carolina. I made my own routine I follow my own diet, following Muscle and Fitness magazine. So I got ready. I went to North Carolina. I was like, oh my God, look at these girls, you know. Blonde hair, tall, pretty, big boobs. And I'm like, well, I don't have any of that. But I ended up placing second. And that's like, I got second place out of 11 girls. And that was it. I was like, okay, now then I went back home and then competed at there was the first national in Chicago. And they were giving 10 pro cards back in for fitness because they wanted to bring it to the Olympia. So I didn't get a pro card that time, but I ended up placing in the top 35 out of 70 something girls. And then from there, I continued competing. And 1999 was when I got my pro card.
Okay.
And then
real quick, Adela, can you shift the camera? You're kind of off center on there just a little bit. There we go. Just a little bit more. Yeah, that way, because you're.
Yeah, right. There and you go. I think you also said to have it on. Where is it? Is it good right there?
Yeah, that's good. That was good. Yeah, you're just kind of like more off this way. So that's just kind of like, that's good.
It's just like the camera go. Okay.
Yeah, there you are.
There we go.
Yeah. So you started in 95. There, you said they handed out 10 pro cards for
fitness. That was in nationals. That was so they were trying to get a lot of competitors to compete in fitness. So they were giving 10 pro cards, and I remember being there. And I didn't speak English that well. I remember telling a girl backstage, I'm like, I just want to get a pro card, and she's like, well, all of us want to. It's like, you're not the only one. So, you know, but they didn't even know what that meant. Like, I'm going to get a pro card, but what is that going to do? That's why it's important to understand what a pro card does. What is like, you know, what division you're competing in. Back in the day, there was only bodybuilding and fitness. And there was a lot of girls that didn't have a background in gymnastics. Right. I didn't have a background in anything. All I, my background was fighting girls in school, throwing rocks at other girls. Just like that was my background, fighting with other girls in Puerto Rico.
I think that in of itself builds enough routines and character. That's for sure.
Knowing how to jump around and following girls, but I just taught myself how to do things. But once I got my pro car. You know, I was having a hard time because I keep asking the main judge, Sandy Williamson, I keep asking her, hey, what do I need to do? What is wrong? How come I'm not getting a pro card? She's like, you need to work on your routine. Okay, my physique was there, but I needed to work on my routine. So then I finally decided to hire a choreographer. I was going to college, so I used my money from my Pell Grant to hire a choreographer.
Yeah, because. Might as well.
Yeah, and I did that. So when I came back and they saw me, they're like, I got first place in routine. I got first place in everything. So I did get my pro car. And then I got invited to compete at the Arnold Classic in 2000. And,
that's cool.
I ended up placing top 10. And the top 10, top five, they get a large amount of money. The first place was $20,000. But then, they gave $1,000 for the girls that placed from 6 to 10. And I remember my coach coming backstage and giving me $1,000. I'm like, is this for me? I made $1,000. Oh my God, I'm so excited. I made some money.
Hell yeah.
You know, so that was the beginning, and I ended up having sponsors, and then like everything took off from there.
Wow.
But yeah, it's been a great journey. Just, seeing how this sport continue to grow, and there's so many divisions nowadays.
Yeah, I was going to say, so from 95 until effectively like 2014 is when you were, or 2013 is when you were competing. And it's very, first of all, I mean, you don't talk to too many people that have that line of work with regards to competing. And I know you mentioned something about how men get paid more, but I'd argue, and it sounds like what you've been able to accomplish, the accolades that you have been able to achieve and the championships that you've been able to acquire probably mean a lot more to you than the monetary value that it could have brought from anything else, you know, but because there aren't too many people that could say, right, that in the same breath, they're like a Lee Haney or Ronnie Coleman or anything like that. And it's, because bodybuilding is a very male-driven sport, it's kind of like, no. I was Miss Fitness 8 times, damn it. Like, that's really cool. And the fact that you have this perspective of not only what you've been able to achieve, but to see the sport kind of evolve over the years, I can imagine it's been pretty crazy to watch it evolve into all the different classes that it is now instead of just bodybuilding and fitness.
Yeah, it was bodybuilding, fitness, and they had a figure, then they had a bikini, then men's physique came along, classic physique, and it's just wellness, you know, it's just keep evolving, and it's nice to see that. it's good for promoters too. I mean, because more classes, you know, you get more athletes. But regardless of, it's just good to see that. And things have changed where when I retired, the Olympia was, the first place was 27,000. And now it's 50,000. Like, that's right. Big for right. all the divisions. So that's really good. And I think for this year, there's more sponsor coming in. So they added more money to the purse of bodybuilding too, and other divisions as well. So, you know, the sport is growing. The natural athletes are going to have a lot more opportunities in the NPC. And that's just what we want to do. I mean, that's what we're trying to add, more opportunities in different ways. We're not trying to take anything away from anyone. It's just, you know, just trying to have other stages, more stuff for all the competitors. So
right. I mean, natural bodybuilding of itself is a growing industry. And I also think that if you're to go into competing or you do anything bodybuilding wise, I think you should maximize your natural potential first and then kind of exactly. take that juncture to see if you want to go in one way or another. And I agree with you. I think if some brand who's already associated with bodybuilding wants to expound upon the natural side of things, like, why not? I don't blame them. But here's the thing is, right, if you go into a new business like NPC, well, it's not really a new business, but kind of venturing off and rebranding in some dynamic, there's going to be hate, right? There's going to be right. people that doubt naturally. And, you know, what they say is like hate is just love and jealousy at the same time. They're only hating because they know that NPC has a real shot of taking over the reins of the natural world, which I'm not opposed to, right? I'm not opposed to, because right now, based off of how the natural organizations are structured, there's a lot of, we got to be the brand. We got to be the federation. We got to be this. But it feels like NPC is like, we just want to have one champion. We just want to have one set of rules, one kind of testing. And it makes it a lot easier for athletes to understand what the criteria is and what's expected of them. Because right now, what I'd argue from my perspective, that we have, like with OCB, USBF, all these different federations, you have so many different criteria. You don't know what kind of testing is going to go for who. You don't know what they're exactly looking for year to year. Whereas, like I was just watching and I saw that you reposted it in the past where Tyler Mannion, the vice president of NPC, he has like these videos. All right, this is what we're looking for in this category.
Yes.
This is what we're looking for in this category. And it kind of gets murky with, I don't want to say the other side, but the other natural organizations, because it's still subjective. But this one, it feels like there's way more objectivity. There's way more clear defined standards. And it seems like what I see, at least from my end, right. is a like an NPC takeover. And I see it all branching out. And like, I assume that like your show is kind of like the beginning of that, right? With
my show is the first one to here in Texas, because there are a lot of natural shows in other states. So I have reached out to other promoters. One of the promoters that is the Emerald Cup in Washington. So he's going to be my head judge. He's been running natural show with the Emerald Cup for years now. And, you know, it's like we both are learning. Also, another promoter is Jack DeTone, and he's also from the San Luis. And he's been promoting natural show for a long time as well. Those are people that I reach out to. Another person that honestly helped me out a lot was Terry from the Naturally Fit. And he reached out to me. He said, "Hey, I see that you're putting a natural show. If you need any help." I was like, "Wow, that was very nice." And we got on the phone and he helped me a lot, gave me a lot of good advice on the testing aspect of it. And I asked him, I said, "Hey, you know, I was surprised that you reached out to help me out because it's different." He's like, "Well, you know, I know where I stand," I said, "and I'm not going to, I know I might never ever get bigger as the NPC, but if I can help you out in any way that I can, I'm going to." I mean, I want you to be successful. And that was very nice of him to do. Right. So, and I respect that. And I mean, even when David Noll promoted, he was in charge of the Naturally Fit. He used to come into my show all the time, and he had a booth, and that was the first, he was the first person to get in there and the last person to leave. And I tell you what, he had he sell everything in that booth. It was amazing. And he would come in, but he just like, he was, you know, never, we don't, we, you can't be negative about other people promoting what they want. The only thing that I seen that I don't like is like, there are too many people put in too many shows. So
yes,
it, then people don't know where to go. And I think that's what, for natural athletes, they need to have a place that they, what am I going to do next? So, so for these athletes, as you didn't, I don't know if you saw what I posted. So they are Ben Weider Naturals. So that show is going to become the big stage for the natural athletes. So the Ben Weider, and they can compete also at the Olympia. I mean, it's, I don't know if you know this, but the current Miss Figure Olympia, she's a natural athlete.
Oh, and okay.
She's won the Olympia 5 times, and she's a natural athlete. So, wow. I mean, genetic wise, I mean, the girl got it, but there are some athletes that they are natural in the NPC, and they take pride of it, and they go and compete at the Olympia. So it's all about what you want to do. Some people want to get there faster. Some people just, you know, embrace being natural and know what their body can do. And I mean, I respect that. That's the way it should be. It's also in a lot of coaches that they just start putting these athletes on different stuff when they don't need to. And the NPC also want to be aware of that. And Tyler has been doing a lot, making sure like his buddy putting all these videos what they're looking for when they see things that they don't want, especially in the wellness division. There was a lot of things going on, especially with the glutes area. And I know there was a lot of girls and doing enhancing parts, body parts that it was not like it should not be. But I think they are really being aware of everything and making sure that things are judged correctly, you know, and and just putting, just emphasizing on what exactly they're looking for, which is very important nowadays.
And I can imagine that's a lot different than when you were competing, like how different that was, the standards. Or so what was it like for you when you were competing? Like what was the standard? Like what were you, I guess, going after every single time, like when you were competing?
Well, it's when I started, you know, first I got my pro card. They were like, you need to get more shoulders. So Susie Carey was the person winning the Olympia, and that's what we look at, like her, how her routines, you know, how clean they were, her body. Physiques were a little bit different. We were smaller back in the days compared to now. Like I never weighed more than 112 pounds on stage. And the girls nowadays, they're huge. And they, they're trying. I mean, when I was trying to do a comeback in 2020. And I was looking, I'm like, man, I don't know if I can do this. You know, I ended up finding out that I had a massive tear on my supraspinatus. And, you know, I just like, I can't compete anymore. But, you know, back in the days, it's just, I was like, I was mentioning, there was four rounds. So we have a 45-second round, which it was a routine that you got to perform 6 mandatory moves in 45 seconds. With a piece of music, and you, we have to do high kicks. We have to do split, straddle hole, bike hole, one arm push up, and a middle split. So that was the 6 mandatories that we had to do in a 45 second. Then we had a 2-piece round. So we come up, we do the 45 second, then we do the 2-piece round. Then the night show, we will do the 2 minutes routine. Which the 2 minutes routine, again, you put those 6 mandatories in there, but again, it's a 2 minutes. Showmanship, you you know, whatever background do you have. My background was I just learned how to do things. But then once I hire a choreographer, I always come up with a theme. So the theme will help you, just you have to become an actor. So I pick up a theme. I was a vampire. I remember when I came back in 2009 after my injury. And, you know, it was a good theme to come back, because it's like, I'm back. No one. I'm back all the way to the top. And I ended up winning the Olympia in 2009 again, coming back after my ACL injury. So then we had the one piece round. Over time, it was a lot. Like, I think it, once they added more division, it started to take too much time. The 45 second and the two piece, the 2 minutes and the one piece round. It was also a lot of money too, because you have to get a two piece. You got to get a one piece. You got to get a 45 second. We used to wear a cat suit, all black. So then they eliminated the 45 seconds, and then they eliminated the one piece. And then we just get the two piece and then the 2 minutes routine. So, you know, it started changing, and but fitness, a lot of people don't know about it. You know, it's right. Like people don't even know that division exists. So whenever I had it last year, I added pro fitness so the girls can qualify for the Olympia. People were like, oh my God, this is so awesome, because you have all these girls doing this amazing stuff on stage, and people don't even know that there is another division. It's easier for a lot of girls if they have a dancing background and compete in fitness. It's easier for them to get a pro card, because once you get a pro card, you can compete in any division you want. So I'm always trying to push. Like, I see whenever we have any type of workshop, I like to talk about fitness. I said, hey, anybody has a background here, you want to get a pro card fast, you know, because there's not that many girls, but some people, they just want to get a pro card, either wellness or bikini, but they don't know that they have another division that can compete into. Fitness is awesome. So back in the days, it was all about that routine round. You know, it was about getting better each time, every time you compete. And you basically, I never finished the season because we were competing. There's so many shows back in the days to qualify for the Olympia. You get a pro card, you got to place top three at a show in order to qualify for the Olympia. And now it's the winner who qualify for the Olympia. So it's because there's so many pro competitors out there, so many athletes, that they have to cut it down. Especially, you know, the Olympia, once you qualify, everything is paid for. So
because I'm still kind of unaware of how you get to Olympia. So what you would do is you would earn your pro card, and then you got to compete in a pro show and win that pro show.
Okay. Yeah, so your pro card, you win your pro card. My show is a national qualifier. So whoever the top two in each division, they will qualify for nationals. So once you go to nationals, you got to place, I think depending on the national show, it's the top three, they qualify, they get their pro card. So once you get your pro card, then you have to compete in a Olympia qualifier, and the winner will get to the Olympia. It used to be points. People used to get points, but I think that they eliminated that because there was too many people. Like, it was, I think in 2020, I remember going to the Olympia, and there was 50-something girls competing in the bikini division. That's a lot. Because, you know, they ended up changing it. So that way it feels more prestigious to go to the Olympia with your whole ticket paid for. Instead of you paying for something, it's like, no. So they now, it's like whoever wins, they go to the Olympia, everything is paid for. They pay for the plane ticket, per diem, and the hotel, everything is paid for.
I think that's what I think you hit it on the head when you say it takes away from the prestige of that experience. Yeah. If everybody just qualifies for it, like, what's the point? And although it's like fitness and your way there is everybody's individual journey, I mean, there are certain measures where we kind of have to compare ourselves to other people and be like, you know what, is this really worth it? Well, if everybody can get in, then what's the point? It's kind of like I don't know if you pay attention too much to the NBA or basketball, but I promise you, you'll kind of get where I'm coming from. I used to be a big fan of it, but the Hall of Fame, it seems like everybody that was just even decent at one point or another is now being included into the Hall of Fame in the NBA. And for me now as a fan, it's kind of like, all right, you made it to the Hall of Fame. Who cares? Everybody gets in now.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really have the prestige and the name that it used to have. But if you start actually applying real standards and you say, hey, you got to earn your way to the show, not just by participating enough, but by actually winning, that is what creates the lure of saying that I'm an Olympian and I can actually go out there and, you know, win that championship and compete.
Right. And also, like I used to, you know, I'm very proud about my accomplishment. I am not the type of person that walk around and I'm like, oh, I won the Olympia 8 times. Nobody even know. But at some point, yeah, I remember, I'm like, no, because there's people that are like that. And it's arrogant. And this is a sport. If you put your mind into something, anybody can win it. And that's what I did. I mean, I worked hard. But at the same time, it's like winning the Olympian and going to the Olympia are two different things. So, you know, I had to start like sticking up for myself. I'm like, I won that thing 8 times. So I competed like 13 times, I believe, and I won it 8. So, because there's people walking around, there's so many pro athletes out there, and it's nothing against anyone, but right. You know, we used to promoters were used to, like, if somebody were a pro and they contact you for a ticket, especially for your show, like, we were able to give free tickets to pro athletes, but it became to the point like, man, there's more pro athletes out there than people. So if I'm going to give tickets to everybody, it's like, boy, this is not going to be good. So, you know, they ended up changing their rules. Like, it's up to us, but you get so many people. Oh, I went to the Olympia, and I'm like, okay, I'm sorry, but I don't know who you are. there's a lot of people that have been going to the Olympia. It's nothing bad, but it's like, you know, they got to understand that as promoter, we also, you know, we got to make some money too in order for us to pay for the venue and everything else. But it's like, it's nice to, when people qualify, when they qualify, they have that experience. Like, they don't even know what it is, especially the Arnold is an invite only. So whoever get invited to the Arnold is also, everything is paid for. So that was like my first show that I didn't have to pay for anything. And I'm like, oh my God, they pay for my, flight, they pay for my room. It was nice. And then when I qualified for the Olympia, I'm like, oh my God, I'm staying at this nice hotel, everything paid for. You know, it's like, it's nice when it's that way, instead of you just going in like, oh, okay, I'm an Olympian, but I ended up paying for my own thing. Like, I think they just wanted to make it a little bit more, you know, much more prestigious in that way, you know, because the Super Bowl of that overall of our sport. So, and I feel the Ben Weider Natural is going to, they're making it like that too. It's an amazing show, and making it like that for all the natural athletes.
Yeah, that's, you know what? So that's what I was going to ask is if, because obviously we have the Olympia. The Olympia is the overall for everything. But what I'm getting the impression of is that the Ben Weider is going to be like the natural version of the Olympia. And that in of itself will be like the, all right, so you got the Olympia, but if you're natural, you go to the Ben Weider's natural, and it's the same effect, saying, all right, I'm the Ben Weider's natural physique guy, or the figure person, or of that dynamic. Is that where that's kind of headed to? Here, go ahead.
I feel like it is. I think it's, you see, they're promoting the Ben Weider Natural. I didn't even know a lot about the Ben Weider Natural. And then I just started talking to Gary Udet, and he's like, oh, no, this show, promoting when he's an amazing promoter. And I have been to his shows before. Mm-hmm. And they bring athletes from all the different countries to be able to compete. But, like, I think that's what they're doing with the Ben Weider Natural, is making it that way. But they also, that's not a stuff for competitors. They can compete at the Olympia because they can qualify for the Olympia at the Ben Weider Naturals as well. And I believe there's going to be 10 shows. I'm not sure how it's going to run, but I know that at the meeting, there's going to be 10 shows that qualify people for the Olympia as well in 2025. Okay. There's going to be more opportunity for natural athletes, you know, as everything move on and move forward. I just feel like it's just, you know, it's just great for everyone. And I didn't even know about the term natty. Whenever you message, I was like, what? Oh, I didn't even know what that meant. So,
oh, right.
Like, I'm learning all these new terms and all these different things too. But it's kind of nice. So there's a lot of good athletes out there. I just feel like there's got to be more opportunities too. And, you know, not just also when you, there's got to be a place for them to go, for the athletes to go. We're trying to figure that out.
Yeah. And I think that I don't want to say that there should be that distinction between natty and not natty, but I think there's room to be able to appreciate both, you know, to say that you're enhanced or you're natural and you're just happy with wherever you are at respectively. I could definitely say that there's a rhetoric against people that use anything like in the natural space in the current natural organizations. But it's just like, you don't know what people's health background is. You don't know what people's goals are, you know, and not everybody has the same set of genetics. If it takes a little bit of enhancement for this person to compete, then, you know, like who are we to say anything? I mean, like we take pre-workout before we decide to go work out. We take supplements and some dynamic to try to enhance anything. Not saying that doing PEDs is the same as like doing a scoop of protein, but it's the same in the sense of you're doing something a little bit more to gain something that you otherwise wouldn't have had to begin with. And I don't think anyone can fault anybody for what that really means for every single person. Now,
of course, yeah.
I think that it becomes an issue when you make it seem like you have to have something in order for you to be fulfilled or for you to have or achieve a goal. I think that's when it starts becoming an issue. But the more people that I meet in the space that are enhanced, that aren't even competing, but maybe just like a gold gym, just doing like a round of TRT. It's just like, hey man, I'm getting tired. My recovery was low. And it's like, all right, well, you know, by all means, I get it, you know? And so therefore I think that distinction, but I do enjoy the fact that natural bodybuilding is starting to spread. And it is like, so you said it's about 10 different shows that the NBC is aiming for.
Well, that's for, there is a lot of shows. Like, I mean, Dave Lieberman, I don't know if you know, he's in Ohio. He's in, all he shows is a natural, that's all natural shows. It's just, they're going to add 10 different shows to qualify for the Olympia. So there are going to be 10 Olympia qualifiers. So natural athletes can qualify for the Olympia, but there's a lot of natural shows all over. The you know, the NPC has been running natural shows. Texas used to have the Shredder. Remember that show?
Okay.
With Dave Gooden. So that was an NPC show. But then, you know, he didn't promote anymore. So that's why we didn't have any more natural shows. And now we're having two in Texas. So mine is the first one. And then the Texas Natural is the second one. But that's like, that's just in Texas alone. But there's all over the states, there's all the different shows going on that are natural as well. So we just want to make sure like Rich Palmer and myself, like we want to have the same type of testing. So everything is protocol. So athletes know exactly what we're looking for. I'm also having a seminar coming up I'm getting ready to post that flyer on March 24th. And it's going to be just to talk about, I want to invite all the natural athletes to come in just so they know what we're going to go, what's going to happen at the show, how everything's going to run. So they are more aware because the posting is also different. I feel, and I just want the athletes to understand like the posting part of it, and invite some of the coaches as well to come in and just, you know, just to see how everything goes and give them more information about what we're going to do.
Right. So you said that it's going to be Urinalysis, right? That's the natural. Well, I guess mm-hmm. first of all, before I get into like testing and everything, what are the categories that your show is offering?
All the categories. We're going to Navas, True Navas, bodybuilding, okay. men's physique, classic physique, figure, wellness, fitness, bikini, all the division.
Oh, okay. Men's physique. Okay.
Yeah, it's all the division.
And then, so everybody has to do urinalysis. And
but the top two.
Okay.
Yes. So the top two are going to get tested. Yes.
Okay. Okay. And then, that's solid. And then for the pro cards, how is it top two as well that get pro cards for every single class?
So I don't know. I think that's the Ben Weeder. That's where they're going to be giving pro cards. So okay. I don't know how they do it. If it's the top two, I think it's the top two, but for bodybuilding, it's the winner. It's depending on the class.
Okay.
So the way is different, the way that they run it. Like, I'm not sure. Each national show that are giving pro card is different, but anybody that qualify on my show can go to any qualifier as well.
I got you. Yeah. Okay. So your show pretty much serves as a qualifier to a qualifier. Is that how that goes?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that's good. You know what? Mm-hmm. I appreciate that because it gives you more stages to go after things. And I think it kind of what we just said earlier, it adds to the prestige of actually winning, and it actually pushes you instead of saying you just won this one local show and now all of a sudden you can compete nationally. So
they qualify for any national show. You know that we have nationals here in Texas in Arlington.
Okay.
So they just we had it last year for the first year, and then it's going to continue to be here in Texas. So that's big because national is like one of the, you know, we have nationals, we have the USA's. There's so many national shows for people to qualify to get a pro car. So then from there, you know, once they get a pro car, then there's a lot of pro qualifiers to qualify for the Olympia. So it's like there's a lot. Like if I go to the NPC News online, all the information is there. Sometimes I even get confused because there's like, okay, what is True Navas? What is Navas? So there's so many different like categories, but there's so many avenues for competitors to go, and like they just don't know. So whenever it comes to, you know, I always tell athletes that you gotta research what you're doing. You got to research the division that you're going to compete in. You got to find a good coach that's going to guide you and not going to push you to do things, because there's no need for an athlete that is doing the first show that they got to be on gear. Like that's just, you know, like what you said, it let their body do their thing, and then mm-hmm. if they want to do something, that's on their own. But you don't, that's the problem, is a lot of the coaches nowadays, I feel like they want to win so bad that they can't control themselves, and they have to put these athletes on stuff. And, you know, then athletes don't know any better. They don't know that there is natural way for them to get ready for a show. I work with the lady who does my HRT, and, you know, we talk about that a lot. Like, she's like, there's a lot of natural ways for athletes to compete without taking anything that they don't need to. But some of their coaches, that's what they do. You know, they basically buy things and then sell it to the athletes instead of sending them to, you know, a professional to look at their hormone, and they don't have to be taking anything that they don't need to. I just feel like it's gotten out of control, because everybody, you look at these people, it's like everybody's taking a lot of stuff. I'm like, I didn't even know what that was when I competed. So why is that happening? You know?
Yeah.
So it's like, I just feel it's just educating and making sure that athletes always find the right coaches, in order for them to have a good experience.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. It definitely is incumbent upon the person to figure out what kind of coach that they're deciding to work with? Because you just hit it on the head. Like, let's say you are very anti doing anything, and that's what this person's all about. Like, there's definitely a conflict of interest that should not be expounded upon any more than, all right, well, let's move on to another person. And I agree with you. I feel like a lot of people that get into the sport don't realize that there is a natural way to do things. And because bodybuilding has had this impression that you need to be on PEDs in order for you to have any result, it's only right for people to think that you would have to get on something in order for you to do this. But it's not until you actually start exploring that and start going into the sport do you realize some of the results that you want are actually very achievable naturally. You know, now in order for you to get to the next level, and maybe within a confined period of time, then you might want to go on an enhancement. But then, you know, kind of like what we've kind of talked about with regards to people that compete, figure out what it is that your goal is for competing, and realize that you've taken PEDs aligns with your goals. Now, if your goal is to become the best bodybuilder of all time and do that and the other, and you want to be bigger than Ronnie Coleman, then yes, obviously there's a couple of routes that are undeniable on how to get there.
Right. But
if the goal is to become the best version of you, you got to figure out what that really means, because doing anything is always going to come with an inherent risk, and it just, you got to weigh everything out. And I do agree with you. It's scary because if, you know, the only reason why I have my confidence and my perspective of fitness and doing it naturally is because I've been able to do it naturally. And when I did my route originally, I did have to go get through the rhetorics of, you have to do this, you have to do that, you have to do this PED, you have to do this, get this result. I realized, like, by the first time I stood up on stage, I'm like, oh, hey, like, this is the result that I wanted, but I didn't realize I could get there naturally until I did it naturally. So therefore, I'm on this end of it saying and telling and promoting to people, you don't have to be on PEDs to get a result. Now, if in today's day and age, let's say I'm a younger person who has had social media impressed on me from day one, that feels like fitness is an objective look that I have to have on Instagram for likes and views and followers, I'm never going to not know anything otherwise. And so it's scary. It's scary for, you know, for, let's say, an insecure kid that's getting into weightlifting. They're going to think that you have to do gear. They're going to think you have to do steroids. They think you're going to have to do this. And like, kids at a young age whose hormones are still developing, like, you gotta lay off the things that are going to change your DNA, because it will have a permanent effect. So
a lot of children.
Go ahead.
So you compete in how long have you competed?
I've done 3 competitions. I did OCB, but I only did I did my first one in the fall of 21, then the summer of 22, and then I did summer of 23 is the times I compete. And yeah, I mean, they're great experiences, but my God, it's challenging. That's for sure. You know? So
yeah, OCB is big. I mean, I remember, I think one of the promoters, he's not longer promoting it, but I think it's one of the big ones. And OCB and then Naturally Fits are the only ones that I kind of know a lot of it. But that's I know that those two are like the big ones to compete in the Naturally Fits. So, no, I mean, I appreciate Larry helping me out a lot, because he just, when we spoke, he gave me a lot of good advice with the testing. And that's like the most challenging thing that I'm finding out is the testing, you know, and how to, because, you know, whenever, like, the polygraph, it's like he was telling me that it was hard, as the show gets bigger, it was hard for them to get that many athletes. It went from, like, have to start doing testing on Tuesday and then Wednesday. So it was just, like, some people cannot get out of work. So, you know, I've spoken with him, and then speaking with other promoters as well, it's like trying to figure out which one was the best. And then we just figure out, like, the Urinalysis will be the best one, because you can not only you can have them go in, and whoever you think is going to be in the top three, you can have them do during the prejudging, and then do them right after the prejudging, that after the night show, you can have them go ahead and get the sample. So, mm-hmm. and we have a nurse that's going to be there doing everything. So we already got all the stuff for the drug testing already. So
good.
We don't have the entries are not opening yet, but it's like we have everything set up. Because that was the main thing. I started listening and looking at other people posting, saying like, if you pay for a drug test, you have to make sure that you get it. So I didn't want to do that. I didn't want people, you know, I know people are going to talk. People are going to be seeing what you do. But that's okay. You know, it's like I was getting a little bit too concerned. I'm like, I need to stop. You know, it's like regardless of the way that I run the show, people are always going to say something. The only thing I can control is that everybody gets a trophy. Everything is in place. And, you know, they have a good experience. They have a nice stage. And that's all I can control. So,
yeah. That's so, yeah. So 2 year analysis, top two. And in general, I feel like no matter what, there's, well, like you said, there is always going to be some kind of haters. There's going to be some kind of people that are going to be critical of what you do. And no matter what, there's always ways around drug testing and some dynamic, you know, the only thing I know that is true is that it eventually all catches up. It definitely, you know, like if you're the person that's happens to win your show and you're using, and then it's going to eventually all catch up in some dynamic. And there's way more to lose in your personal brand and personal respect for yourself than it is to gain of winning that. And if that's something you want to leverage or take a gamble on, then by all means, you know, but, I do enjoy the fact that there is like, you guys are doing this, at least the standard is set. And
It's important to have that. I spoke with one of the Jack Tutone from St. Louis. He said, you know, it's you got to look at it this way. You're not going to be making money. So we're not doing this just to make money. You know, as long as I break even, I don't care. But it's like people need to understand. It's just giving athletes more opportunities to have a stage. I like to have a nice stage. So, you know, the show is going to be, so Saturday I'm going to have the open. It's going to be the NPC open. And athletes that compete in the natural, they can cross over and do the open. So Then on Sunday, I'm going to have the natural show. But on Saturday, it's going to be the fitness qualifier for the Olympia. And then Sunday, I'm going to have also a little bit of a fashion show for all the sponsors that are coming in, because the venue that I have this year is in Bastrop and it's a school. So a lot of sponsors like to be inside, and I cannot do that this year. So they're going to have to be in the lobby area. But for that reason, we're going to have a fashion show for sponsor that, because we get a lot of sponsors with clothing. So they can be able to display their stuff on stage. But for next year, I want to have two different venues, you know, for the show. So because as the show gets bigger, I think it just makes them feel a little bit more special. I don't want the athletes to feel rushed. So that's why they have their day for their show. Some promoters, just depending on the cost of the venue too. Next year I'm coming back to the Palmer Event Center.
Okay.
So we'll see how that goes. I'm trying to find a different venue for the natural show to have it earlier. So that way those athletes can compete at my show too. So they will compete at the natural and then they can compete at the open as well. Okay. So we'll see how that goes, but I'm trying to have two different venues, two different dates. So. And see how that goes.
So this one though, you said you have all the open and all the competing on the first day, which is
on the on Saturday.
Saturday, June, is that June 2nd or June?
No, that's the 8th. Saturday, the 8th. June 8th is the open, and the 9th is the natural show.
Okay. So. And then the fitness Olympia qualifier is on that open day.
On Saturday. It's going to be on Saturday. Yes. Yeah. So.
Okay. Oh man. I'm actually excited for you on that. Like who else would I rather have host a show if I was a fitness athlete trying to make it to Olympia than yourself? That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was nice. Last year we had the Karen Fitness Olympia with Missy Trosco. She was sponsored. She sponsored the prize money, and then she also made this beautiful trophy of herself doing a straddle jump. It was pretty cool. She ended up hurting herself, you know, the Olympia last year, so she's not going to be able to be here this year. But yeah, she ended up tearing her ACL, so now she's, you know, recouping to come back again. It's crazy because we both went through that. Like, she is, we're talking about it, and I even sent her a video of my comeback whenever I injured my knee. And then she injures her knee, but she injured it on stage. Like, it was pretty bad. Like, the weight. I mean, that girl was, she was so ready. But, you know, she's strong. She's coming back stronger. One of those things. But she stepped up and she came and she sponsored the show. And that's like fitness. That's what we need, because the prize money is, and then we also have to pay a sanction fee. So it costs a lot of money. So we just want the athletes to show up and compete and then, you know, get that qualification for the Olympia. But it's fun. I hope you can make it too. I don't know where you're at. Are you in California?
Or? I am in California. I am. I plan on moving to Texas here in the next couple of years. So if I can't make it to this one, I for sure will try to make it to one in general. I mean, and in general, my entire curiosity for the NPC taking on the natural realm is something that I'm looking forward to seeing how it plays out, you know? Yeah. So no, absolutely. I would love to.
No, but I think it's just, people need to know that the NPC is, there's a lot of natural shows. I mean, if you in California, you look at your district, there's natural shows there too. So it's everywhere. Mm. It's just like here in Texas, I guess, Texas is so big that for the longest time we didn't have any. And now we do, and people are like, oh, well, why are the NPC trying to get into our lane? They stay on your own lane. I'm like, no, the NPC has been having natural shows for a long time. It's just here in Texas that we didn't. And some promoters, they just don't want, because it's a lot of work. And there's a lot of paperwork too, that you need a lot of signing stuff. And some people, they promoters, they just don't want to deal with it. I don't mind, you know. A promoter's telling me, man, I give you heads up, because I don't, that's a lot that you got to do. I'm like, it's not that much. Once you get things in place, it's easy, you know.
Right.
So the most important thing is giving those athletes a good stage and a good experience. And that's what I'm aiming for.
Right.
That's the main thing.
And how many athletes are you expecting for this? Like, how many athletes to show up last year, and how many athletes are you expecting this time around?
So for the open, the natural show, I have no idea. I've been getting a lot of good support from people that, some coaches, you know, that coach a lot of natural athletes. They just feel like there have been so many people promoting shows that they don't know where to go. So these coaches, they are up for it. They're like, yeah, I wanted to support your show. So, I mean, I don't know how many natural athletes I'm gonna get. I mean, for my open show, we get over 150 athletes, and then with a crossover, you know, just the number goes up because people do different classes. If you get about 150 bodies, it's good. There's so many shows in Texas that when I first started promoting in 2011, like, my show grew so quick. I remember having it in at a school close to my house, and they had to kick us out because the show all of a sudden grew, and we had over 400 athletes. It was awesome. But yeah, but now it's like there's so many shows that we had to be on top of going, promoting, making sure that, you know, the experience is good, because it's a business. We're competing with other promoters. But we try to make it in a way that we all, you know, help each other out. So compete at my show, compete at another show. It's all about being out there and just promoting what you do, and, you know, giving a good experience is the most important thing. So they will come back and they will talk about your show.
Yeah. So, yeah. I'm really appreciative of the fact that you understand that it's a business, but also you want to make it about the athlete's experience as well as understanding you want to make it better than the next person. And it's all like a dog eat dog world, but competition and having to invest into your brand because of the competition is a good thing. Is exactly what it makes us all better. I mean, it's just kind of like competing in bodybuilding, you know, like you have, like you just said, like you kind of came in, you came in second place during one of those years. And it's like, oh, wait, I got to get better now. I can't win. So therefore, overall, it's a catalyst towards being better, you know? And so I'm glad that that's on the forefront of your mind of constantly improving and making that's in a better everything. Experience.
Yeah. It's everything that you do and you want to put in, you know, you just don't know why I just have a show. If you're going to have a show, you want to do it the right way. You want to make sure that it's a nice stage, that everything looks good, nice venue. You know, that's one of the main things. It's like everything went from when I started promoting to nowadays, it's just completely had changed. Like, I remember whenever I wanted to give medals for the athletes, and I'm like, I'm not giving a medal that is this big, like, I want a big medal. Yeah,
big ass medal.
You know, like, I know, because it's like, you know, I remember like ordering this medal one time and I got it. And I'm like, this is a joke. Like, it was like when the sticker put on, I'm like, I'm not giving this to anyone. Like, you know, right. So finally, like, I spent time and finally found the right medal. And I tell you what, like, I found good medals. They're expensive, but, and now I'm dealing with China. So I'm going like, finding bigger metals, 6 inches, 7 inches. Like,
wow. Like,
whatever.
Okay.
No, because, oh my God. You know, you want to give something nice. You don't want to give them like this little thing or those trophies that they look like super big trophies, but they're kind of fake. Like, I was an athlete. I know how it feels. You know, you want to get nice things, like, especially if you're paying an entry fee. If you're going to get something, you're going to get nice stuff. So we give stuff for the overall. Backpacks, belts, tiara for the girls, and the overall trophies. I always get the sculptures and I get the big ones. So
ooh, it's like, all right.
They walk away with a lot of stuff. So I like that. Oh, okay. Whatever I can give.
May I make a future recommendation for trophies? So
yeah,
My OCB placings, I got these daggers and I got these like effectively like these knives and swords. And like, I remember the overall got this giant sword. I think a sword would be really cool, or get something like some kind of like a weapon as like a trophy.
Yeah,
no,
we can't do that. We were doing, we were able to do, swords, and I gave some too. Mm-hmm. Trust me. Like, I give a lot of different things. But somehow it's like we have to stop that because something happened, and it just, for the purpose of safety, we're not allowed to give swords anymore. But then we were able to do the daggers too. And the big one, I remember getting like the bigger swords that I could get, the better.
So, exactly. So
I had a show in Puerto Rico, and I remember my nephews like playing with them. I'm like, man, these things are sharp, you know. Yeah. Like, and they were both playing. Like, so I'm like, I don't think this is a good idea. And you know, somebody gonna get mad backstage and then stab you because
they can play. God, that'd be terrible. See, I should have won. Oh God!
Yeah, no, no. But those. There's a lot of different cool stuff nowadays. So
yeah,
we just said they just got to be safe. Safety, you know, come first. So that's why they ended up not allowing to give those anymore.
I'm not gonna lie. I have two of my daggers underneath my bed, just in the event someone were to come in and try whatever. Like, they're there for safety. See? For me. I legitimately have. Like, you're gonna stab me with the fourth place dagger? How dare you? Like, that's what I have.
That's pretty cool, though. Yeah. No, so then now they stay with just the medals. You know, whenever people start giving medals, they tell them, like, you cannot give a medal less than 4 inches. Because it was like this tiny little medal. It's like, man, I don't want that. Or, you know, you just wanted to take pride in what you give at your show because it represents you. So. That's just always been the main thing for me, that like what I have on my show, what I give away. I got like the bottles, got all the bottles.
Ooh, all right.
The logo.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and the medal. So getting everything ordered, you know, everything goes fast. So, but it's, I'm excited. I'm very excited for the natural show too, and see how everything goes.
Yeah, I'm definitely excited for it. Well,
so the 25th is March 25th is the seminar, and I'm going to tag you whenever I get the flyer out. So, yeah, yeah. So,
okay, so March 25th is the flyer for all the information. June 8th and June 9th is the event. Yep, and that is where in Texas is it at again?
Bastrop. It's in Bastrop, Texas. It's about 30 minutes from the airport. Yeah.
Oh, all right.
It's a nice venue. It's, you know, it's a performing arts center. It's very nice. And it's, I can't wait. It's going to save me a lot of money this year, but next year we're going to the Palmer. I like the Palmer a lot better though.
That's right. That's right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, all right. Well, do me a favor, stay on for just a little bit after this. And for everybody else that is wanting to even participate, how can they get a hold of you? On Instagram,
so
or
Instagram is NPC Adela Garcia, and then also Miss Fitness 08, that's another Instagram, and then the NPC Adela Garcia.com is the website, and we have all the information there for the athletes as well. So they can reach out to me via Instagram, or you know, through the website, they can also contact me as well.
Outstanding. Yes. Outstanding. Definitely looking forward to it. And for everybody else that's listened up to this point, I hope you guys have the opportunity to check out the Adela Garcia Classic, as well as look into the whole NPC line of natural athletes. I think it's pretty interesting what's going to happen. But for everybody else, thank you all for tuning in. Until next time, guys, deuce.
Thank you. Thank you.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho, O, H to the O-V. I used to move snowflakes by the O-Z. I guess even back then you can call me CEO of the R-O-C.